from DATADVANCE. And he is talking today about how machine learning and artificial intelligence accelerates automotive design processes. Feedback on three different applications: battery design, structural optimization, and system design. Laurent has more than 25 years experience in CAE. He graduated in 1995 with a master's degree in mechanical engineering and worked with major European aerospace companies as simulation expert before he orienting his career towards business development. Over the last 10 years, Laurent has held different director positions. In 2016, he joined DATADVANCE headquarters in France as a CEO. And DATADVANCE is a former spin-off of Airbus Research and now independent software company. And it is specialized in deployment of digital twin via low-code cloud architecture based on machine learning and artificial intelligence foundations. Now he will show us how cool is that.
Yeah, I hope so. Yeah. Hello, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be here. It's actually my first conference since the pandemic, so I really enjoy it. So let's jump into the topic. I would just say one word about the company. It's true that our expertise is in design space exploration and optimization. So we are experts in parametric modeling and parametric optimization. But the second aspect is also the predictive analytics. So machine learning, AI, and this trendy topic these days. I have to say, by the way, that it has not always been so trendy, because when we started, or my colleague started, I joined the company later on, when you were talking about neural network, for example, it was kind of suspicious, you know, and people didn't really trust in that technology. And for the joke, we were developing that kind of stuff. And we even hid the name neural network, and we changed that into a high dimensional approximation, these kind of things, just to hide, because people were just thinking that neural network was like black magic, you see. So now it's democratized, okay? Everybody trusts it. And if you look at the exhibition area, it's everywhere, ML, AI, and cloud, and these kind of things. So I'm happy we are in that business. As for the roots, we come from the industry. So we started as a spin-off of Airbus, the aerospace company. The company was driven by Airbus during 5 years, and then they stepped back from the shareholder, and we are now totally independent software editor. So we develop very advanced stuff for engineering, that's our sweet spot, and for quite advanced industries. Headquartered in Toulouse, despite the fact we come from aerospace, we now deploy our solution everywhere. Second market for us, or maybe the first, is energy today. Just to let you know, automotive comes next. And we have great references. So let me step back a little bit on the history of all these technologies we are hearing about these days. And let's look back. In the 90s came the concept of functional mockup and CAD. That was just a great step forward then, enabled by computing power, obviously. In the 2000s, it was simulation-driven design and model-based engineering with all these solvers, etc. Again, computing power was a key driver. Then in 2010s, probably you have heard about model-based systems engineering. So this is the concept where at system level, you move from document-based engineering and specifications on paper and targets, etc., to something digital, and so that was another great step forward. Another one, just as a consequence of the first, is the concept of digital twin. So here, the digital object, whatever it is, it can have very different forms. Can be an application, it can be a machine learning model, it can be an aggregation of all of that, or even complex workflows. But the concept itself of digital twin is that it is, whatever it is, numerical object, it is connected to a physical asset. and it communicates with that physical asset in bidirectional mode. So it means that the physical asset can send information to the twin, then some predictions are done, and then the twin sends back some prediction and recommendation directly to the asset or to an operator through a dashboard, for example. That's the concept of digital twin. And finally, artificial intelligence. That's the last step, and this is where we are. So question, how does it accelerate the, what is the added value of that in engineering? So all I have mentioned here is something you can actually combine, and today we have the opportunity indeed to mix and match this technology. So multidisciplinary analysis and optimization combined with machine learning, AI, also combined with data collection, aggregation, and management, and finally collaborative frameworks. In my company, we are also experts in that area, but I will not cover it today. I will just focus on the pure ML AI stuff and not necessarily on the architecture. So what is a predictive model? Predictive model is a substitution or black box of something that exists, which is defined by data. We use the term very often of surrogate models. It is a surrogate of something physical. You have, by the way, the various names here and vocabulary which is used. So meta models, surrogate models, response surface models, all of that is actually the same, pretty much. There are slight differences, but it's essentially the same idea. So it's a black box model. It's a function. It's a mathematical function, usually very light, which is obtained by training. So we have to run in a loop on a data set, on data, let's say, and the data sometimes already exist in the case of a data set. Sometimes you have to execute a model in the back to get the data. So it can be an analytical model, or it can be even a more complex simulation model in 3D using finite element, all these kind of things. The beauty of these predictive models is that it can predict the behavior of your system, whatever it represents, is just a fraction of a second. So the cost to get the model is, of course, expensive, because you need to have data. And to get data, if you are running 3D simulation, that's a challenge sometimes. But sometimes the data already exists. It's just sleeping somewhere and ignored. And this is what many companies do right now. They collect the data. They don't even know if they will use it today, but they collect the data just in case. And then at some point, they will maybe do some machine learning to create predictive models. I'd like to say also that the predictive models are not necessarily something disconnected from the physics. I mean, to get a good predictive model, especially in engineering, you need to think about the physics and what the data represent in the back. So people tend to think, when they ignore, let's say, ML, AI stuff, they tend to think that you can take a huge bunch of data, throw it on Amazon, and then you get a model. No, that doesn't work like this. There is engineering in the back, and usually in engineering, we don't actually do deep learning. So complete blind exploration of the data to produce a model, no, that's not. Unfortunately, I wish it could be like this, but it's not. So the models we create are usually based on shallow learning. So it's not deep learning. Most of the engineering applications do not require deep learning. Now, we see deep learning coming for very specific and very interesting application in engineering. But most of the cases, it's shallow learning. So you need to inject a little bit of know-how and understanding of the physics to get a good model. They can be built from any source of data, whether the data exists, like it can be test data, historical data stored on an SPDM system, for example, or it can be, again, this concept of digital twin, where you have a physical asset streaming data online through IoT or wired network to your machine learning environment or model analytics environment, and then the prediction will be done, and then you will process or you will send that information back to the asset. And finally, of course, 3D simulations, that's another type of data source, but it's the same as an analytical model, except that simulation time is huge. So an interesting application or usage of machine learning and AI models is in optimization. Maybe you've heard people who do optimization based on predictive models. So usually they build a model using machine learning and AI. So once they have their model, they plug an optimizer on top. Here, I'm not exactly talking about this. I'm talking here about embedding the ML AI layer, so that technology, within an optimizer, which is a different story. Because there, the optimizer itself will control the training and the quality of the predictive model. And the end user actually will never see that predictive model. It's embedded, it's inside. And that technology is really interesting because it accelerates the design process. I will explain in the coming slides. The ML AI techniques you might need to create your models can be very different. So it's a zoo of application and algorithms. So that's one of the big challenges, of course, in engineering. When you have such a big list of algorithms, which one to choose? And once you have even chosen the right one, hopefully, you still have to tune it. And that's not easy. On top of that, you usually need to come back to the data organization to make it fit, let's say, for the requirements of that algorithm. So this is where you get one of the first obstacles on the way to with this ML AI stuff. There are some solutions, like some additional heuristic layer that you can put on top of these algorithms. That's very interesting. So there is a solution here which has been used for the use cases I will show, which is called smart selection, and which does the selection and the tuning of the algorithm for the end user. So of course he can deactivate this, but for beginners that's a very useful tool and a way to democratize this advanced technology. So now I'm going to talk about the use cases where we have applied all that technology. And one in EV, which is very interesting, is about battery design. They are characterized by high energy density, and the microstructure here plays a very important role. So let's dive into the topic. So we are going to focus on the lithium-ion secondary battery. So these are batteries that charges and discharges when you have the ions, you know, moving between the anode and the cathode. So this is there was a presentation earlier this morning explaining this. It was very nice. So it's exactly this same concept and just an illustration of that. So what's the challenge here? We need to improve the battery, generally speaking. So it's about improving capacity, performance, and hopefully weight. And what influences that is actually conductivity and diffusivity. So these are the two parameters that really determine the or have an influence on this capacity, performance, and weight. So it's about microstructure, of course, and material, and this is something we can simulate, thank God. The battery here, performance, so conductivity and diffusivity, are actually dependent on other aspects of the material, which is, for example, the conductive aid, so the binder. And the feeding ratio of the particles of the anode and between the anode and the cathode. So if you increase, for example, the binder and you fill with more binder, you get a better conductivity. But then it decreases the porosity. So then the diffusivity is dropping. And so you see here we have a trade-off relationship. There is one objective that competes with the other. If you improve one, you decrease the other one. That's a typical optimization problem, as you can imagine. So here in that first example, you have a high conductivity because, as you can see, the binder is everywhere. On this second case, here the porosity is much better, but conductivity is low. So we have to find the compromise between these two. We're going to use some software solution here. First of all, a workflow integration solution, because we have to run in loops. This is an iterative process, and we should not have man in the loop, and we should automate all of that. Geodict also is another software which has been used here to simulate the battery behavior. The goal for this optimization is to maximize conductivity and diffusivity, or at least, as I said, to find the right compromise. Then we're going to do a pure machine learning AI task at the end. We want to extract a predictive model from that kind of battery digital representation. So as I said, we use a workflow integration concept here. So you have a box here. So this is a diagram which simply shows the engineering process. So each block does a unit task. And once it has done something, it passes the output to the next block who does another task. This is running in loop. There is no man in the loop. We execute then that software, Geodict, which will predict the conductivity and porosity. So that's the whole idea. So we have to define the parameters. So the parameters are here. So you have the feeding rate of the binder, the particle packing rate, then even the particle size. So the size is defined by two parameters, X direction and Y direction. If you have same value, you have a circle. Then particle orientation and the binder contact angle. And we're going to use here surrogate-based optimization. That's what I mentioned before. The simple reason is because a geodict simulation is very expensive. You have to get the proper and accurate output. You need a 2 hours run or something. And if you have to run in loops to do ML, AI, or optimization, that's, of course, a big issue. And this is where many people think that, oh, okay, my simulation is too expensive. I would need a huge computer capacity if I want to do optimization or ML. We will show you in the next slide that it's not really the case. You can do this at with even very low number of evaluation. So here are the results, just very, very directly. You have conductivity on X and diffusion rate on Y. And you have here the so-called Pareto frontier for the multi-objective optimization. So this is the line of compromise. If you are at the top here, so with low x-axis, then it means that diffusion rate is high. If you are, so I will go to the extreme. If you are here, it means that conductivity is high, diffusion rate is low. And here you have kind of intermediate position. So that's the idea. So it's, of course, the end user decision to choose which point on this line of compromise is best for him. Okay, so what we can see here on the result is that, first of all, the particle size have an interesting shape. They are completely flat. And actually, the particles are oriented towards the ion path. So very thin and so with a long X axis. So you see the particle size is minimum here in Y direction, and then in X direction, then we have a compromise. We have a compromise here. Okay, so that is the first step. The second step is to now build a predictive model from that digital representation of the battery. So in what you have seen before, a predictive model was used, but it was internal. The optimizer was building it internally, and the end user doesn't really have access to that. On top of this, the predictive model is not necessarily good for the entire design space, because the optimizer will precisely limit the number of evaluation and go straight to the interesting area of the optimal region. So, I have not. I will have another slide on the number of evaluation. But here, Yeah, you see, we have, this is the real number of points that have been evaluated. So it's about 120, 150. It means that you can get the Pareto frontier with a quite limited number of evaluation. We are not talking here about thousands and thousands of evaluations. So let's come back to the topic. Now we want to create a predictive model. For this, Ben, we have an interesting aspect here. To get the results from GeoDict, we need a fine mesh. We can use a data set coming from this GeoDict simulation, but they are quite expensive to get. So there is a trick here in predictive modeling, so machine learning and AI, where you can actually use two data sets having different level of fidelity. And the combination of the two will actually speed up the predictive modeling process. Let me explain. If you have a first data set here with very limited amount of points, let's say you have very few points, like 5, 6 or something. These are the black points you see on the curve. If you do a machine learning task on that, then it will probably miss the real behavior of the model. So there is a gap here, as you can see. So the red line, which represents the predictive model, goes through the point. So it's good at the location of the point, operating position. Away from them, then it's not so good. Then the idea is to complement that with another data set. That other data set is actually low fidelity. It has much more information, but then each point is very cheap to get. So how do we do this? We simply coarsen the mesh. So we have two models, one which is fine mesh, the other one which is coarse mesh. With this second data set, then we have much more points. You cannot even see them. They are so small here. So we have hundreds and hundreds of points and very cheap to get. So the problem with this one is that the responses are not very accurate. So what we get a gap again. But this time, look at the predictive curve. The shape is okay now. It's similar to the actual curve. So this second data set will give an information to the machine learning algorithm how to recalibrate, let's say, the behavior. We call that technology data fusion. So you mix two data sets having different level of fidelity. If you compare, I will then speed up a little bit. If you now compare the results, you see here the quality of these models. The high reliability data set model. So the one you will build on this small data set with very high fidelity results. This one is really not good. The R-square is very small, so a huge error for the conductivity. For the diffusion rate, it's a little bit better, but not so great. Now, look at the second data set. If you train a model just with that one, it's not good neither. You have R-square 0.33, so 70-ish percent of error. And here, it's 35. But now, if you combine the two, this is the magic. You see, we have 88 as a percent as R2 and 0.96 for the diffusion rate. So by combining the two, we provide very meaningful information on where are the precise, let's say, values and points, and what is the general trend of the model. Yeah, conclusion for this use case, we have used optimization to optimize the microstructure of the battery. We have built a surrogate model based on that. And the number of evaluation was very small, actually. It's not thousands and thousands of evaluation again. Same for the predictive analytics and the model we have built. That's quite a cheap, let's say, to get that. So it's not deep learning. You just need hundreds of runs, let's say, to get something interesting. This use case here is from another application. It's a mechanical simulation and interesting in the same spirit, let's say. So surrogate-based optimization has been used, except that the disciplines were different. It's model analysis, so eigenvalue analysis and mechanical simulation. So we want to optimize the CAD, the shape of this PCB cover here. And we have a parametric CAD for this. The similarity with the previous case is that it's a parametric model, and we use SBO, surrogate-based optimization. Here again, the very interesting information is that to get the Pareto frontier, we only need 16 points, 16 evaluation per variable to find the Pareto frontier. So again, I'm fighting against this idea that you need a huge number of runs to make it happen. No, it's a limited number of runs, and you can get enormous added value from this limited number of run by using ML AI combined with optimization. The last use case then in the last minute is a combustion engine use case coming from Mitsubishi here. We want to create a predictive model for the combustion engine. So we have a few parameters, variables to get this Weber function. Probably some of you know this. We want to recalibrate an analytical model, MATLAB model, to represent this accurately this Weber function. So we actually have data coming from measurements. The data coming from measurement will be then provided to an optimizer that will recalibrate the analytical model, the MATLAB model, so that it fits these curves. We use for this optimizer. So we just calculate the discrepancy, the gap between the curve, the measurement curve, and the predicted value from the analytical model. Then we want to minimize that gap. And when the two curves matches, it means that your analytical model is good and you have a good fit. Once you get there, this is where you can apply the machine learning because you have a reliable analytical model. You apply the machine learning on that, and then you get a predictive model, which is actually good. You can then, at this point, export it in FMI. So FMI, functional mockup interface, is well known in systems engineering. So this is where your combustion engine model is exported in this neutral format, and you can import it then in a multi-physics simulation environment like this one. So this is Simulink, and this is NVH simulation. So we have this combustion engine model, Weber function, injected into the NVH simulation to, of course, optimize the NVH. This is pretty much my last slide. Once you have explored and adopted all this technology, then this is where you can leverage these predictive models in the concept of digital twin. And again, the digital twin built from data coming from a physical asset. So imagine you have sensors on these components and subsystems, will then be used to train models and then to predict the behavior of the model. So this is the kind of things and strategy you can use to predict, to enter predictive maintenance strategy, for example. And then the prediction of the models will actually be provided in a dashboard to the operator. So I have shown you three examples of ML AI. Globally, this is a technology accelerating engineering process. It makes optimization even possible where most of the time it's not possible due to the heavy simulation in the back and the number of runs you can do. And once you have adopted this technology, then the next steps are what? It's about maintaining and deploying these models. Because it's one thing to create them, it's another thing to maintain them and make sure they are well used by the entire population in your company. So here comes collaborative environment to maintain and share, deploy these models. They can be deployed across all domains of the company, and they can be used in digital twin strategy, again, with this monitoring of a physical asset. And finally, you can plug into this the data and the data management layer, which allow you more predictive analytics because data will feed the entire process. I'm done, and ready for questions.
Thank you, Laurent. Are there any questions? Oh, you were first.
Hi, Simon Thiel from Volkswagen. Did you benchmark your surrogate based optimization against other optimization techniques like Bayesian optimization, for example? Because I think 6 design parameters and 120 evaluations, I think it's possible also with Bayesian. So do you have some performance numbers?
You're absolutely right. As I said, we're coming from Airbus. So as soon as the technology had been developed, a huge benchmark has occurred with hundreds of evaluation functions, and compared with commercial product as well as open source, etc., Bayesian optimization and many other types of optimization. Yes, we have benchmarked that technology, and the results were quite good. I can share that benchmark if you need.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
But you're right about the number of evaluation, and the design space here was not that big, so yeah. it's of course a kind of a super heavy solution for a light problem, but it works for heavy.
Okay, thank you.
Next question, Axel.
Axel Linschke, CPS Consulting. I'm not sure if you have seen the industry requirements, but your outlook looks very similar than what I have asked for. And you've shown there overall and the whole vehicle described by your surrogate models and surrogate application there. For you mentioned for maintaining and for distributing the models into the overall company. And do you believe, and maybe your estimation, it's possible to describe a whole vehicle with all the functions with that, and then use your predictive models for new vehicle layouts?
Yes, that's right. So machine learning AI is well known for providing information based on a family or a baseline of product, and then from there you can predict the next generation of models. As long as the design space is pretty much the same, so the topology of your system should be quite equivalent. So there are, of course, a lot of constraints you have to comply with. But the concept itself, yes, that's a possibility, of course, to predict the next generation of vehicle or subsystem based on families of systems that have been processed in the past. The question of the deployment is really another one. It's more about the logistic of all of that. But it's a real industrial obstacle. I mean, many companies have deployed models here and there in research centers, etc. And at some point, they have a huge amount of knowledge captured into this, but are unable to share that properly and deploy it at scale and maintain them. This is where you need a strategy in place. And this is where the cloud solution and collaborative environment can be an enabler.
Okay.